catch out there.
Oh, that is a magnificent catch.
Great catch.
Welcome to Fox Sports Gold, where we take you inside some of Australia's greatest sporting achievements. In 1995, the West Indies ruled world cricket. The Calypso Kings had been the dominant force in the Test arena since the late 70s, and on the back of a fearsome pace attack and a free-scoring batting lineup, they had compiled an imposing record. Unbeaten in a Test series for 15 years and unbeaten in a Test series at home for 22. That is, until Mark Taylor's gang of gum-chewing Aussies arrived in the Caribbean in March of 95. The seventh Australian team to tour the West Indies was depleted by last-minute injuries to pacemen McDermott and Fleming. Yet, despite these injuries, the four-test series shaped as a fascinating contest between the unofficial world champions and the ambitious Aussies. Less than convincing in warm-up matches, the Australians headed into the first test at Kensington Oval in Barbados, a ground where no Australian team had won, with no momentum, key injuries and history all conspiring against them.
Mr. Magoo! You may be blind, but I can still see you! Anytime you see bad boy come through, right type of mode!
Yeah, 1995, West Indies, they were the number one team in world cricket.
Oh, that is a magnificent catch!
The West Indies were the benchmark for a long period of time.
Just shows you how serious these two are.
Follow! Travelling to the West Indies and playing against the West Indies, you always felt you were playing the best ever.
That's it.
We wanted to change that. We had the firepower to do it. We had the self-belief. You know, we were thinking that we were part of, maybe changing history and maybe, you know, changing the flow of world cricket, maybe, you know, getting us to step up to the plate and sort of take the mantle away from the West Indies.
Oi, oi, oi!
A lot of people, and probably including ourselves, thought, oh, we're going to get absolutely hammered here. We just haven't got any of our dominant players.
With a borrowed Australian blazer, Carl Rackerman, the 34-year-old fast bowler, flew out for the West Indies as replacement for the injured Craig McDermott.
We had injuries to fast bowlers as well. We had replacements coming in. So it was not an easy one for Mark Taylor. But the great thing about Tubby with his captaincy was he was always very positive and he always got the best out of you and he backed your ability no matter who you were, whether you played one test match or two test matches or 100 test matches. So from his captaincy point of view, I think it was just an even keel right throughout the series.
We've just got to continue to do our job and to do it effectively, to work hard and try not to lose any matches whatsoever. Because as far as they're concerned, we are perfect and we have to live up to that expectation.
So we really thought it was an opportunity to go over there and beat them on their home soil.
And they had a bit of an intimidation factor about them, and we spoke about that before the tour, you know, thinking that we were good enough to win this series, we had the players to do it, we prepared a lot harder and a lot better than previous tours to the West Indies in 1990, 91, that was my first tour there, and we went with a bit of a negative sort of mindset, so we're really conscious about thinking that we could win this series, and we trained very hard. You know, we replicated match conditions in the nets, we're bowling bounces to each other, hitting each other in the head.
Came over here knowing I was going to face a lot of short pitch deliveries.
I can't wait till the test starts.
Thousands of Aussie tourists have come to the Caribbean to see the series. The doyen of Barbados cricket, 94-year-old King Dale, who has ridden to every test match here since 1906, is backing us.
And they want us very bad in this match.
So we were very well prepared and the self-belief was there before we played that first test.
First day always counts for a lot and can set the tone for the whole series. So hopefully come day one, if we're batting, Slats and Tubby can get after them, and if we're bowling, we can get some early wickets and set the tone.
Crowds were a lot more affable, if you like, than maybe the Australian crowds. I mean, it was a lot more of a party atmosphere. The music's playing, different sort of smoke drifts across the ground at different stages too during the test matches. You know, and they're all on the run and all that sort of stuff. So to me, you're playing test match cricket, but it was also like you were part of a real party atmosphere, if you like, too. And that's because of where you were playing, it was, you know, on the islands and such an idyllic location. But for me, yeah, it was a real eye-opener.
The man that's going to give it to me, Gravy, the entertainer here, and have a look at that beard. Gravy, well, where'd you get the beard?
My hairdresser, she designed it on. She knew that Australia's coming and this is their favourite colour.
Look, that was an exciting time for me because I wasn't in the original touring squad. I mean, I only came into that test series because Damien Fleming did a shoulder.
Yes, well, I think Brendan Julian's got a good opportunity here. I mean, that's what it's about, test match cricket. You're not in the frame and suddenly you are, and you have to grasp those opportunities.
The thing I remember the most was it was a carnival atmosphere, and I was very nervous, and I was thinking if I could just get my first over out of the road in the right area and don't get smashed around the park, I'd be pretty happy.
I would assume the West Indies wouldn't have seen much of Brendan Julian and probably didn't really have him on their radar as a bowler to watch out for.
Really wants to be bowling a line about off stump just outside.
The first ball I bowled, I was just hoping to get it in the right area and get it down the other end. That's all I was worried about, not bowl any wides or a no ball. Second ball, I just threw it up there and Williams just sort of didn't quite come forward and he drove at it and nicked it straight to Mark Taylor. I couldn't believe it. I was a bit of a shock thinking, what's just happened?
Gone, caught it for a slip, Williams goes.
Just picked up a wicket and it went so quickly in terms of getting the wicket, a bit of a celebration and from then on it was a pretty good hour.
He's gone. West Indies have lost both openers now. He's gone. Richardson caught behind, flashing outside the off stump. And this is real crisis now for the West Indies. They're 3 down for 6. Richardson goes without scoring. So a big welcome for Brian Lara. Welcoming the most famous left-handed batsman in international cricket at the present time.
There he is. The prince who became a king 1 year and 4 days ago.
Great opportunity for Brendan Julian to get an early wicket.
Well, we always knew Brian Lara was going to come out really hard, probably be aggressive against all the bowlers. He always wanted to dominate the bowlers, especially the quick bowlers. We had a young attacker with Rifle, McGrath, myself. So he would have looked at that bowling attack and thought, you know what, I've got to get on top of these guys. And that's what he did.
Off his toes, characteristic of Lara. There again, just a little overpitched again. And just with a delicate flick of the wrist. And that's where he's so strong off his pad. That was short. And Lara has dispatched it effortlessly for 4. There's a very characteristic shot of Brian Lara off the hip. A little bit of the D.I. Gower in that as well, isn't there? The famous clip, the left-hander's clip off the hip. Glorious shot.
Lara and Hooper played particularly well there. I mean, they were class players, and you knew someone from, you know, that lineup was going to make runs.
Well, he's found the gap. So typical of Brian Lara to find the gap in the field, and there wasn't much of it. Didn't quite get hold of it as he wanted. It'll go all the way. But he put enough effort into it to carry the ball to the boundary. Very quickly in position.
In the West Indies, and particularly Barbados, you can bowl good deliveries that can get hit for 4. It's a very flat wicket, it's very quick, and the outfield's fast as well. So you can go for 5 or 6 and over very, very quickly. And Hooper's the same. He's the type of guy that will hit the ball in the air no matter what.
Get up very early, did Hooper. Of course, not afraid to strike the ball in the air, which he can afford to do with the field up like this. Advanced to the first run, met him on the full 4.
Against those guys, you've always got a chance of getting them out, but you've also got a chance of going for a few runs as well.
That's gone. What a way to bring up his half century.
It had to take a special delivery, a special catch, or just something out of the blue to dismiss those two guys. But that partnership was certainly getting them on the right track.
Century partnership in 92 minutes from 132 balls. Shane Warne with the last over before lunch. Oh, glorious. Oh, my goodness.
You always felt you were in the game with Carl Hooper. You could bowl a good delivery and you could either get hit for four or you'd pick his wicket up. So for my type of bowling, I always knew that I always wanted to bowl him probably just outside off stump. You never want to attack him on the pads. You don't want to get too close to him either. So I thought if I gave him a little bit of width, maybe on a good length, I'd either go for four or end up with a catch in the slips, which is what happened.
He's got him. Got his third wicket, well bowled. Makes the breakthrough. Carl Hooper goes caught in the slips.
He bowled well, Brendan. He's a bit of a wicket taker. He got the ball in the right areas. That left arm sort of slinging action, not that easy to pick up. So, you know, he probably caught them on the hop, but, you know, good luck to him. He bowled really well in that first, you know, 3 or 4 hours.
To get Brian Lara, I couldn't believe it.
He's gone, I think, at the third attempt. Lara looked around to Lloyd Barker, looking for some confirmation. But it was Steve Waugh to his right at the third attempt on the cut.
Well, I can see now why Brian Lara looked behind him. He wasn't too sure if that ball had actually touched the ground. Very difficult to say there, but Steve Waugh claimed it, so...
It's sort of, you know, he had a couple of goes at it, and then it, what actually happened is it actually bounced back off the ground, back into his arm, but, you know, he was sort of looking out that way, and...
That's why Brian Lara was a bit doubtful. That ball definitely hit the ground.
Sometimes when you're the catcher, it's very difficult for you to, you know, to make sure that you have caught it. I mean, he's not a cheat, there's no doubt about that. I mean, he thought he caught it, so he claimed it. Obviously, the crowd and Brian Lara were pretty upset about it, and I can't see replays that really decide either way whether he did catch it or not, so I'm happy that he caught it. One out, one bounce is all right, isn't it?
Well, at that stage, we just felt that we were on top. We didn't want to really take the pressure off.
Beat out that rhythm and drum as the day goes on.
Tubby threw it to the two guys that have done it in the past and did it again.
Oh, he's gone. That's a beautiful catch.
It was mainly up to Glenn McGrath and Shane Warne to clean the tail up.
Well, he's got him and Venkat has given him out.
I mean, we always, as a team, pride ourselves on our fielding. Bob Simpson was our coach on that tour and he was big on doing the basics right, and obviously fielding is one of those, but yeah, the standard is really high.
Well, he slogged it in the air. Blewett is under it at cover, and White make the mistake.
It's in the air and easy.
We bowled the West Indies out for 190-odd, I think, in two sessions on the first day in Barbados, which is a real bonus. I mean, the pitch was quite flat and the outfield's fairly quick as well. So, you know, anything under 300, you think you've done well. But 195, that sort of set us up for the rest of the Test match.
That's the end of the innings. Murray goes. The West Indies are out for 195. And Australia have the early advantage in this opening Test.
Not a bad start. Obviously, it's good to get the ball coming over. I'll pick up a couple of wickets, but there's a lot left in this game, so I'm not going to take anything for granted in the second innings.
As long as you get the wicket in the same amount of deliveries as it does in Australia, it'll cost you a dozen or 15 more runs because of the boundaries. Is that something that, at the top of your mark, you've got to concede?
I think you've just got to wipe that out of your head. Obviously, you can go for six and over here quite easy. You've just got to think, OK, if I hit it for four, then that's it. I'll just worry about the next ball.
We have not won a Test match for 9 Test matches. Now's a good time,
yeah,
isn't it?
We're due, that means, to me.
Inside Cricket, Ashes Edition, bringing you exclusive previews and reviews of every crucial Test, only on Fox Sports.
I love the photography books and I love how they've been able to inspire me.
The most magical section for me is the children's section.
Without needing to speak somebody's language, everyone talks music.
My passion would have to be obviously reading, and I love to travel. Just having like an awesome adventure.
I like getting the bad guy. In most of the crime books that I read, we get him.
These are just some of the well-read people of Dimmicks, whose passion for words and love of reading can help you learn something new every day.
And of course, we had to go out and bat well against a pretty good pace attack, the two Benjamins, Walsh, Ambrose, Carl Hooper as well. So it was never going to be easy. basically, if you're playing against them, it was a matter of survival against the fast bowlers. And if you happen to make runs, well, that'd be a bonus. But it was really tough cricket. Mark Taylor and Michael Slater took the brunt of it early on, softened the ball up for the rest of the middle order.
You learned something about Josh Reward for the work that he did later on.
It's four to Michael Slater, no need to run for that. Lovely timing by Michael Slater. Mark Taylor repeats the dose from the other side of the ground.
Oh, that is a magnificent catch. Magnificent catch. And Slater could hardly believe it.
Well, West Indies needed something. Yes, there's the anger. He can't believe it. He really did crack that ball. What a catch by Stuart Williams in a deepish gully. It went flying and he caught it.
And look at the crowd, dancing with joy. They haven't had much to dance about today. He's got that run through.
Tubby was always going to be the guy that was going to dig in and get you off to a good start, and that was very much how Mark Taylor wanted to bat. Him being the captain leading from the front, he copped a few on the body as well, but in typical captain style, he hung around, gutsed it out, and probably allowed us to really get off to a good start, which held us in good stead.
That's a better shot, that's placed. Nobody can stop that.
Steve Waugh, that 60 off of him in Barbados, probably set the tone for his whole series.
He's got that one away very comfortably.
And Mark Waugh, having those two guys bat well together in completely different styles, I think just threw the West Indies in that first Test match.
He's got that one away, there's a chance, and he's been put down.
We all chipped in with runs. There was no big scores. In fact, Ian Healy top scored was 70 odd.
Yep.
He was a fighter. He's a gritty sort of player, a bit unorthodox. He looked ugly, but he was quite effective. And you know, that 74 in testing conditions, made the big difference. There was a lot of starts at the top of the order. Then he came in and got a half century and sort of, you know, got the momentum back in our favour. And obviously with a pretty decent first innings lead.
Down the ground, Walsh goes back. It's over his head.
Very characteristic.
Batting with a senior player at one end that had played the West Indies a lot was probably good for me. I was lucky enough to have a little bit of luck along the way, but a partnership with Ian Healy probably just set us up in terms of batting with a tail and got us over the line in terms of the first inning score.
Well, that's a typical Brendan Julian stroke. We've seen it so far, I would say, three times in the innings, where he just puts the left leg forward and swings through with the bat.
The result is four runs for Brendan Julian and Australia.
Here he goes again. Ambrose has a chance. Just couldn't get to it. Not even with his reach. He's shaking his head.
Sometimes, you know, if players can't get hundreds, it's very important that everyone contributes all the way down the line. And we actually spoke about that before the tour, that it's going to take all 11 players in the top side to bat well, even if you're a tail-ender. You know, every run's important. So, you know, that came to fruition in the first innings, in the first test, and Healy top scoring.
Glorious drive from Healy. Doesn't have to run for that, he knows that.
In the air, over the head of the fielder, gone. Magnificent stroke. So the end of the innings, but I'm sure that Ian Healy is going to get a great reception from his teammates.
There you are. It's as simple as that, isn't it?
And I dare say from those West Indians who know this game so well, it's been a really important and tremendous innings by Healy.
You know, got us to that that lead of 150. At one stage, it looked like we're just going to sort of get past their first innings, but that really got us into a good position and good momentum.
Yes, Courtney Walsh down here with me. And Courtney, I guess quite simply a tough day at the office.
Yeah, very tough day at the office. But we're happy to get them all today. And as you can probably see, the wicket is not offering much assistance to the quick bowlers. But with the wicket so slow, you know, it's not good for shot making either. And it's a hard time for fast bowlers. Tomorrow is another day, and let's hope it's a better one for them.
The pressure was more on the West Indies. You know, leading into the first 3 days of that test match, the crowd, the people just were, I think, shell-shocked how well we'd played. So we were quite happy, obviously, going into that second innings, and we felt quite confident as well that we'd knocked them over in the first innings. But we had a lot of work to do, but I think it was more just the atmosphere we felt comfortable in their environment.
Plenty of Australians, somewhere between 700 and 1,000 Australians have checked into the Barbados, and most of them are here.
I mean, when you're ever going into bowling into the second innings and you've already got a lead of a healthy 150 runs, never easy for the opposition. They always felt that, you know, you got to get over that deficit first, then start. So we always felt we had room to play with and we could be aggressive with our bowling.
Well, these two young players trying to make a career out of Test match cricket, this is what's going to come into play. The big footholds here, there's plenty of them for Shane Warne to work into. All helpful to Shane Warne's spin, and would give him some irregular bounds.
We didn't think it was going to be easy, you know, to bowl them out so cheaply again, given the conditions.
Any particular batsman in the West Indies in the top order, on their day, could turn a game around very quickly.
We played that late, Williams, and played it well.
But we did a great job. Shane Warne and Glenn McGrath did the job.
And he's gone. He's gone. Took it hard in the chest. He parried it, controlled it. Yeah! Phil Prickett's behind. McGrath is struck. And so the West Indies young openers have failed again.
Yeah! And joy for the Australians. Lara turned and walked solemnly. They're up, as we suggested, and that's what Shane Warne tried to entice from Hooper.
No, I think that's fair cricket. I mean, from the Australians' point of view, they're really in the box seat.
Well, it's a good hit from Hooper, which may clear the fence. It has. Ian Healy, in fact, has wandered down from his position to have a chat to Shane Warne.
Carl Hooper was the type of guy that would hit the ball in the air a lot, and we always knew that.
Brendan Julian, the man who, in the first innings, did plenty of damage.
So it was never going to be short to Carl Hooper because he would just jump all over it.
Oh, sparring Hooper.
I remember thinking, I've always got to pitch the ball up. Yes, I'll probably go up a few runs, but I've got a good chance of getting a wicket either caught behind, in the slips, or anywhere, and poor rifle at mid-off. Just a chest mark. Nice and easy for the Victorian.
He's gone. Hooper has hit the catch to mid-off. The West Indies have lost their fourth wicket for 57. And are really in further trouble.
Well, Richie's decided to have a dash at that as well. That's the shot they're in, enticing, and he's hit it beautifully on this occasion.
Typical Richardson stroke.
Look, you always felt that once one batsman got going for the West Indies, you always felt that they were going to score very quickly and get themselves back into the game.
Glorious stroke. Is this a one-day game?
That is Richie Richardson at his best. Having been distracted for a couple of days, he seems very focused today, Michael. McGrath's body language is making an observation. Richardson's observations are a little more convincing.
But Richie Richardson certainly gave us a bit of a scare.
He's bowled him in the last over before lunch, and a fifth wicket has fallen, and Australia now within reach of a famous victory, their first at Kensington, and within 3 days.
A chance here. You're running the wrong way. Great catch. Stephen Moore, great catch, Stephen Moore. And, well, what a breakthrough for Australia.
I think Glenn McGrath, that was the series I felt that he put his mark on being an Australian Test cricketer.
Leg before. So McGrath gets another wicket. West Indies have lost their seventh.
I mean, he was very inexperienced. He was 12th man a lot going, you know, into this Test match series. I think everyone knew the talent that he had. I mean, he was paper thin. There was nothing to him, but we knew that, you know, he was one of those bowlers gets in nice and close to the stumps. Good pace, good bounce. I mean, history will show that that is the emergence of him. I mean, he got his opportunity, and that's what good players do. They make the most of their opportunities, and he didn't look back after that series.
That's the end of it. Huge swipe. So the West Indies in no mood here to extend the match any further.
He was always a good bowler and a young bowler. Always, he got picked for Australia at a young age, but he always showed the signs that he was going to be something special. Great competitor, line and length bowler. No frills about him. Any conditions he'd run in for the captain, to pick up wickets in the West Indies. You know, the tracks are pretty flat over there. They're not really ideal for fast bowling. And that was, the start of something special for Glenn. And he went on, as we know, to be one of our great bowlers. And you always thought that he had that in him.
It's 9 for 180, West Indies.
I think in the end, we bowled him out for about 183. Shane Warne and Glenn McGrae are two, big guns. Two world-class bowlers did the job.
That's the end of the innings. Bowled all over the shop. Shane Warne gets his third wicket. And Australia will have to get 40 runs to win the match.
Australia, they've never won at this ground, so really a historic moment. One can't help but think of the Australian captains that have gone before, of Ian Johnson, Bob Simpson, Ian Chappell, Kim Hughes and Alan Border, how all of them tried so desperately to do it, and now Mark Taylor has a priceless opportunity.
Yeah, we were chasing 39 to win the Test match, and Mark Taylor and Michael Slater went out there with great intent, and they knocked them off, I think, in probably about half an hour.
That's the sort of authority you expect from young Michael Slater, into position very quickly. But he's dreamed of playing against them. He's dreamed of playing that sort of shot. Goes again, short, inside it quickly, rolled the wrist on top of it, hit it square for four, it's a glorious shot.
Michael Slater looks very much as if he wants to get this over quite quickly. Four more. So it won't be long now. Australia just need 39.
With some poor shot play. Good footwork by Mark Taylor.
Just the one needed now. So no ball, and the match is over from a no ball. Rather anticlimactic finish. Stumps have been taken out. Swarms coming up on the ground. Australian flags all over the place. This is a significant triumph for Australia. And a depressing defeat for the West Indies. Bit of a confrontation and a scuffle as we saw in Trinidad. On this occasion, a spectator is involved with the Australian captain, Mark Taylor. Well, really, this shouldn't be happening at the end of a match. The happiness is not reflected all around the ground. The majority of the people here have been once more stunned by a West Indian defeat on a ground where such a thing was inconceivable up until a year ago.
As I said before the match, we haven't really played our best cricket on this tour, and in the last 3 days we've just got it all together. We bowled well, fielded well and batted well, so great game for us.
Yeah, it was a great win. I don't think we could have played any better than that. The bowling was tremendous, the fielding is very good, and the team spirit was great, so yeah, it was a tremendous win.
And they're not...
Nice to do an interview,
so it's exactly the start we wanted in this Test series, and it's had a lot of hype about it, and for us to come back after losing the one days, I think it's been a great effort by everyone.
We said that one or two of the bowlers had to put their hands up, and all the guys did. Now, Paul Rifle, Brendan Julian, Glenn McGrath, man of the match, all the guys really put their hand up and wanted to be out there and do the job for Australia.
Every series that you play, the first Test match is just so crucial. So I think that gave us a real sense of belief that, yep, we're good enough to beat these guys on their home track. We did it at one of their iconic grounds at Barbados.
You know, I think it surprised everybody, the ease with which we won that Test match, given the comments before the tour and a few injuries to our bowling stock.
You come halfway around the world, you dream about a Test like this, and I was here.
I think the 3 days of that Test match was a bit of a whirlwind. It just fell into place. We batted well, we bowled well, we caught well, we fielded well, so It was just one of those test matches that we couldn't believe we'd won in 3 days, and it set the series up.
Australia's first ever three-day victory in the Caribbean has given the players a much-needed two-day break. The Aussies were today basking in the glory of their historic victory. While the players were recovering from the celebrations, their coach Bob Simpson was recovering from the thrombosis in his left leg. He's only just come out of intensive care. The blood clot had been potentially very serious.
If that clot had been in different parts of the body, it would have moved more quickly, then, you know, it can be quite dangerous.
A typically determined Simpson will not go home. He'll rejoin the team in Antigua next week. While playing golf with daredevil Shane Warne, Brian Lara said the West Indians batted horribly. He admitted they were complacent after Craig McDermott went home.
Took them a bit too lightly in the first test match. And the guys are looking forward for the remaining of the series. It's nice to lose the first one, as I said, not the fourth one.
At the moment, it is absolutely teeming here in Antigua. It was like this overnight. The spectators huddled under all the little vantage points they can find. The ground staff came running out with the covers. Something like 9 hours and 6 minutes was lost by rain. See some of the Australian players there. They're just watching some vision of some highlights that we actually put through to the monitor of the players from both sides in their room. So the players there are pretty keen just to do something, get out of the boredom of the change rooms.
As the Aussies arrived at the ground, they knew the elements had conspired against them. They'd be facing an uphill battle.
It's a wet day here.
After constant overnight rain, the outfield was sodden. Groundsmen worked with sponges, then a helicopter was flown in to dry the bowlers' run-ups. In all, almost 3 hours' play was lost. Mark Taylor declared the Australian innings closed at 7 for 300. With the West Indies needing 257 to win at more than 7 runs and over, Williams started aggressively.
Pulled that one again.
Lara played some delightful shots.
Lovely shot.
Before falling to Julian.
Hold him.
With no chance of a result, the game finished early. The West Indies 2 for 80.
Now we're very confident at this stage. Two test matches left, we've only got to win one of them.
Alan, you've been in this position before. You've had the West Indies down and out on the ropes, but you haven't been able to deliver the knockout punch.
This is traditionally when the West Indies are at their most dangerous, and they seem to be able to find another gear when they find themselves in this position. So, this particular test match has all the ingredients for being something special, and it's great to be here for it.
Yeah, well, look, I was a late start. I didn't get there until the third test in Trinidad. If you think back, it was the first year that Queensland actually won the Sheffield Shield that I was part of. So I'd played on after retiring from international cricket for Queensland. And so I was busy trying to help Queensland get across the line for their first Sheffield Shield win. So that's a pretty good excuse.
Yeah, going into the third test match, we're obviously up 1-0 still, so we really want to, you know, drive it home. And you sort of walk out, you know, a couple of days before the first ball's bowled, and it's just green. And then even, you know, rocking up that first morning, and there's just grass everywhere.
Well, usually here at Queen's Park Oval, I'm usually in pretty familiar surroundings. Not so today. Let's have a look at this pitch. As you can see, there's a lot of grass on this pitch, and very green grass at that. Usually when you find a bit of grass here in Trinidad, it's a bit lower than this. This grass is very long. It is naturally growing out of the surface of the pitch. And so I think it will certainly help the fast bowlers a lot. When I say fast bowlers, I mean the bowlers that will be pitching the ball up to the bat, not those that will be slamming the ball into the pitch, because this pitch has a fair amount of moisture, and I expect that it will be a little bit slow, but lots of seamers out here.
If you lose the toss and have to bat first, it can be a bit of a nightmare. And just looking at the surface they were going to play on, it was very green.
The pitch was probably not up to test standard. It was underprepared. There was quite a lot of moisture in the pitch, a lot of grass, and it was just very hard work. You need a lot of luck against the bowling.
Well, Mark Taylor, going into the third test match in Trinidad, he was due to win a toss, because if you ever wanted to win a test match on a pitch that was seaming around and was a minefield, and you're up against Kirtley Ambrose and Courtney Walsh, that's the toss he wanted to win.
Mark Taylor called tails for the sixth time in a row, and Mark Taylor, for the sixth time in a row, has lost the toss for Australia. Richie Richardson winning the toss and electing to send Australia into bat.
As batsmen, you look at it straight away and just go, OK, this isn't going to be easy. We're going to really have to work for our runs here.
Off the fae pad.
Their fast bowlers on that pitch is always going to be really hard to negotiate. And, you know, quite frankly, they bowled really well and we just weren't up to the challenge.
He's gone. Michael Slater suffering the indignity, the embarrassment of a duck.
He's back and across and he's just hesitant. And, oh, no, he shouldn't have played at it. And straight to Junior Murray and that's out.
So Australia with a horrid start here. Mark Taylor goes, Jimmy Adams takes the catch, and the high-fiving West Indians are jubilant.
One-hand catch, Murray, wore outside off stump, just hanging the bat there, and Ambrose, who's been dormant for two test matches, seems to have got the brain in gear.
And in comes David Burney's 100th test match for Australia.
Burney was probably the guy that was the senior figure on that side that had played a lot against the West Indies. He'd played a lot of test cricket, but also Burney was a folklore for, you know, all of us growing up. If you're in a stuck in a position where you're getting dominated by short, quick bowling, he was a guy you could always rely on.
That's just seamed away and bounced. And that is what we call at home a Jaffa. There's not much you can do with that, and David knows that. It's you just got to strap your seatbelt on. Be prepared to take a few knocks here, I think.
Well, this is almost unplayable stuff here. Courtney Walsh is making the ball talk.
Yeah, but not in David Boone's language. And David knows that. There's not much you can do. That's just seamed away everywhere. And that's moved out a good 6 inches there, and you think Mr. Walsh is not having some fun here.
Well struck. Fractionally short and put away very well by Boone.
Over the top goes Boone. And on a slow pitch, the player who plays that shot is a pretty comfortable way to hit a boundary. Around the mark. Steve Waugh has just shown his intentions.
And Steve Waugh making sure that he, when he goes up north in the bridge, he goes at a full tilt.
Steve Waugh whacked that in front of point. And he'll get the ball a little bit wet as well. So I don't think that Richie Richardson would be too pleased to be out there at the moment.
I don't think anybody would be too pleased to be out there at the moment. It's really coming down quite heavily, as you can see in your picture there. Finally, they have decided that they are going in, and here come the covers. Don't think that pitch needs any more moisture than it has at the moment.
Well, Alan, as if the Australians have enough on their hands at the moment without the disruption from the rain.
Well, these two bowlers they've got at the moment, you know, they're not too many better two running around, and they've got vast experience from England, and so they use the conditions perfectly. I mean, if it's a hard, bouncy wicket, they might throw the ball into the track a little bit more and have the bloke stuck in diving. But on this sort of wicket, they've kept the ball up and bowled magnificently.
I've never played on a wicket where the ball was taking divots out of the pitch, so it was really tough work. I can't see any side getting over 250 on that wicket.
It's that bad?
Well, it's just, it's unprepared, yeah.
Well, a play about to resume. And these two men have got the task of trying to resurrect Australia's innings.
And then we came out after that rain delay, and I think Steve Waugh was more annoyed that there'd been more water put into that pitch because of the rain.
Here's Ambrose.
Seems to be some sort of discussion going on there as well, but we haven't seen too many of this sort of delivery, and they're exchanging a few words out there, batsman and bowler. It's, shows you how serious these two are.
He had said something probably to himself, where Ambrose thought he said it to him, And then Steve Waugh said something like, you know, just hurry up, get back and bowl. I'll do the batting, you do the bowling. And all of a sudden, steam was coming out of his ears.
Well, that's a bit silly, stirring Kirtley Ambrose up.
I wouldn't have fancied facing Ambrose in those conditions. Would have been difficult.
What if Stephen said, well bowled? Certainly fired the crowd up here, Tony, and what if this will be a little bit quicker?
I suppose it was sort of along the similar lines as what we'd spoken about in all our team meetings, how we're going to draw a line in the sand and not be intimidated. We're going to bounce their bowlers. And Steve Waugh just decided, well, you know, I'm going to get my chest out and then I'm going to stick it to him.
Well, that certainly is a very astonishing confrontation. At any time in a test match, to see two players eyeball to eyeball as they were then is very unusual. Richie Richardson had to step in there very quickly and in the end had to virtually pull Kirtley Ambrose away from the confrontation. Majid Khan, the International Cricket Council match referee in the background there, would have looked at that with a great deal of interest.
I'm not too sure who started it, but it was watching, you know, two headstrong batters. What test cricket's about?
The next, it was a really quick delivery, played and missed, had the gloves up high.
And as we predicted, AB, it's got him fired up.
Well, certainly brought the test match to life. I don't know whether the viewers can hear the crowd, but they're certainly loving this competition, and I must admit I'm enjoying this from 150 yards as well.
Umpire David Shepherd has signaled there, that's the second ball over the level of the shoulder.
Typical Stephen, he's not going to back down from a fight. He knew the conditions were in the opposition's favour. Maybe it was just a way for him to sort of maybe try and put Ambrose off his game.
And Steve Waugh, probably the way he bats, he doesn't like taking a backward step and he likes to fire himself up.
Kirtley seems to have fired himself up. Now we've got test cricket at its best.
Well, that was a pointed moment in the whole series, not just this test match. I mean, Ambrose needed to fire up. And I remember having the pads on, couldn't believe that I had to go in, you know, maybe in an over, maybe in two overs time, it was all fired up, Ambrose. That's one guy you don't want to fire up.
The end of an over which will be written about in all the papers tomorrow and will be discussed for many years to come by those who have watched it.
I would have thought on a juicy wicket when he got sent in against the West Indies, in particular Kirtley Ambrose, you don't want to fire them up at all. If anything, you just want to play low key. Stephen didn't do that.
I got the feeling, I mean, I'm only just recently retired at this point, and you know, I got the feeling there was a real mood change within the Australian camp. You know, for years and years and years, the West Indies had been dominating Australian sides, and you know, I was part of that era, and it was just very hard to get on top of them. And I just got the feeling that there was a change in attitude.
Threw him.
That typified that they weren't going to back down from the fight.
Steve, to his credit, was the only batsman that really scored some runs.
Sliced away, there's no third man, and this time it will have enough carry to go all the way. So that brings up the Australian 50.
He'll probably look back at that innings as probably one of his better ones as well. I mean, without his innings, I mean, it would have been an absolute debacle because there was hardly any of us who fired a shot apart from him.
He's gone. Richardson has taken the catch. Ambrose gets his third wicket. And Australia are four down for 36.
The fast bowlers were really hard work, and against world-class fast bowlers, you need everything in your favour.
Beaten, confident appeal, and he's gone. Benjamin has struck, and Blewett has gone.
He's dropped it, he's caught it. What a reflex chance. That's a tremendous catch, dropped first of all by the keeper. And Richie Richardson showing remarkable reflexes for a man who is the oldest out there for the West Indies.
Just when we thought they were going to get on top there, wickets falls.
These things happen, and it can happen very easy against good quality bowling, especially on a pitch that's doing a bit. You need a bit of luck. Didn't bat particularly well, obviously. I mean, that's a major collapse, and it's pretty hard to win a test match when that sort of thing happens.
Great delivery, and Steve Waugh is the man in the centre of the jungle.
He was in form, but he really showed then, you know, how much heart he had, and yeah, that was a gutsy knock for sure.
This is what the West Indies call chin music, right, the finger and the thumb.
You don't want to stir him up, but you know, he likes to, you know, fight fire with fire, Stephen, and you know, sometimes it gets him going as well with the bat.
And talking about upping the ante, that really is a limited overstroke. He gets 4 for it. And he also gets a 50.
Very well deserved 50 here from Stephen Moore. He's worked hard, he's copped a few on the body. One very painful blow on the elbow. He's obviously decided that every now and then he's going to take it to these bowlers now batting with the tail.
And he top scored in that game, so it didn't do him any harm.
In the air, Ambrose can't get it, he dropped it. Well, he was so slow to move to it.
And that's a fine stroke down the ground. It's a little bit slower than normal, the outfield, because of the rain we've had here, but the fielder won't catch it. And that's a boundary to Steve Waugh. Well taken. Jimmy Adams at short leg.
Got it right in the middle of the bat, and Jimmy Adams just stuck out his hand. It went straight in his hand. On an up-and-down green wicket, you would have thought you'd get an easy one off the ribs, and he picked it up. I clipped it all right, and he hit it, and right in the middle of his hand.
Very good catch. And looks quite happy about it, too. And he doesn't.
Oh, look, you can understand it, because the surface was a difficult surface, and you can go through those runs. You know, you're most vulnerable when you first walk out to bat, and it can happen against quality bowling. Let's not forget that the West Indies had at their disposal.
Taken. Simply taken by Lara.
Oh, perfect delivery to the tail ender. And if you're going to bowl a tail ender, Mikey, then that's what you do.
Ambrose is right up there. He's in that grand final. He just had a bit of everything. You know, he had the height, obviously, which made it difficult. He had good pace, great control and stamina to go with all that. So, you know, he had the whole package. And so if conditions were in his favour, yeah, it was a nightmare.
With a storm that has been shattered. So the storm shattered in more ways than one by Kirtley Ambrose.
Well, Kirtley's a great bowler, and, you know, we found out about that in Port of Spain.
He's gone, has he? Yes, he's out. So Ambrose back with a vengeance. 5 wickets to Ambrose.
One of the great bowlers that you're ever going to face, but on a juicy wicket in Trinidad, you don't really need to give him too much assistance, and you don't need to annoy him as much as well. So for Ambrose to pick up 5 wickets, he had his tail up, the West Indies had their tail up, and they had a sniff of knowing that they could equal the series.
Now, there was a discussion between yourself and Kirtley Ambrose out there. Can you explain what happened?
No, it was just tough cricket, tough test match cricket. I mean, I'm out there with a bat, he's out there with a ball. We're trying to do our best, and sometimes tempers flare over, but I thought it was played in the right spirit.
Any repercussions from that incident?
No, he bowled pretty well, I batted pretty well.
Did you notice a difference in the West Indian bowling attack today?
Yeah, Ambrose seemed to pick it up a couple of yards, bowled a lot quicker and with a bit more venom, but and you need some luck to score some runs. And they held their catches, so I didn't see any guys play any bad shots. It was virtually impossible to score runs.
Okay, then you also got hit on the elbow. How serious was that?
Oh, at the time, I wasn't sure what was going on. It sort of went numb, and then there was a bit of a dint in my arm, so I wasn't sure whether it was any serious damage. But just for a couple of balls there, I wasn't really able to grip the bat that hard. But after that, I sort of, I got one on the finger, so I took my mind off that. At this stage, just sort of severe bruising, but it'll be okay.
How do you rate your half century today compared to your other innings? Was it really tough?
Oh, I'd say it's the hardest test 50 I've ever got.
And yes, what an important period for the Australian team. And without trying to be over dramatic, this next 4 hours may well determine whether Australia can actually take that Frank Worrall Trophy home.
We always felt there was enough in that pitch. It was so damp from the rain that we knew that if we just bowled some pretty good line lengths that we'd get our rewards anyway, and we did.
Gone! First ball he's received from Rifle and he's gone. Outside edge, and Williams has failed again. Wonderful strike for the Australians, a wonderful strike for Rifle.
still moving up the seam a little bit.
Well, that's it. Richardson just looks at his elbow. Umpire Shepherd raises a finger, and the West Indies have lost both openers now for six.
We had him in trouble early on. We had two quick wickets that we picked up. So we always thought we had a bit of a sniff.
Jimmy Adams now comes in with a very difficult situation. Oh! The average nearly came down very sharply with that delivery. That's a magnificent stroke. It really is a high-class stroke by Lara. Brings the crowd to life here. Magnificent. It was a ball which really didn't deserve that type of disdainful treatment. It's beautifully held. And he's given him, beautifully taken by Mark Taylor. That's it. We would have got a view of that very, very late indeed.
What a fantastic pair of hands this man has got.
The pitch still seamed around a fair bit, but it was definitely getting easier.
Four runs. Fine leg glance. All straying that next side and the ultimate penalty to Raw because Hooper looking to play shots. There are three boundaries in that area. Hooper's gone straight down the ground and it may in fact go over the fence. Right down in front of us here, yes it has. So Steve Waugh gets hit for the first six of the match in a very low scoring game.
Just wide. In the air. They just have got the fingertips to it and it just carries the four. Delicate.
Windies, you know, typical, they weren't going to go down without a fight either. They were still in the gut contest, so at 3 for 80-odd, you're looking at building a, you know, some sort of 250s, 300 lead. Wasn't to be.
Gone! Gone! And McGrath has struck back, showing tremendous mental discipline there. Not to drop his guard. Get up, stand up! Gone. Mark Waugh. Exceptional hands and the delight of the Australians. That was the one they needed. He's out, drop, caught at the third attempt by Slater. Benjamin driving at Warne. Slater, who's caught pretty well in this series, but there was a few palpitations there. It was in, it was out. A sense of excitement here. High fives over the wire.
And you just get a bit of a run on, you know, and the crowd get into it and you can just feel the tension rises.
He's got it. McGrath has taken his fourth wicket. Ambrose goes very smartly. And the West Indies are now 8 down.
What a great effort for the Australians to claw their way back into this game. And once they get a smell, they know what to do with it.
So the new batsman coming in is Courtney Walsh, coming in at number 10.
Actually, Courtney Walsh made 14 in that that first innings of 138. Oh.
Well, he's played that pretty well. The ball all the way, got right over it, guided it down between third slip and gully.
Goodness knows how, because he was one of the worst batsmen I'd ever played against. Every now and then he'd actually play a real good shot.
Yeah. 32 here. And that's not a bad little push from it on. It carries the West Indies ahead.
Basically, he looked terrible. And, yeah, he was a bit of a laugh, actually. Every time we come to the crease, the crowd had sort of erupted. And
that runs even for that.
He had a very ungainly style. He used to dance around, look like his shoes were on the wrong feet. And his bat, you know, just didn't look comfortable. He didn't look very natural at all at the crease.
All fun out there between the two of them. And as Dean Jones has said, Courtney Walsh has dished it out often enough during his career to know that... Run out, easy run out here. Muff. And that's the first fielding error the Australians have made throughout this match. Around the world.
you know, make every sort of delivery, you know, a bit of an accomplishment for him, and it was in the end.
If Courtney hit that one, it would have landed up in the Hilton. Well, if this is baseball, if he plays and misses one more time, he's out.
You know, if he managed to keep out a ball, he'd sort of dance around like a praying mantis.
Like the Mexican two-step.
He made the most of it. I mean, you would have thought that Courtney had just scored 100 the way he was jumping around and high-fiving.
That's the reverse hook.
That day, 14, that was a pretty good score for him.
And that's it, end of the innings, full toss. McGrath picks up his sixth wicket, and the West Indies have an overall lead of just 8 on first innings. They're all out for 136.
The best performance by an Australian here in Trinidad. Glenn, I know this is going to be a question asked probably a day or so in advance, but when Damien Fleming and Craig McDermott went home, your captain, Mark Taylor, made the point that somebody, if not all of the bowlers, have to stand up and be counted. It appears that you've relished that opportunity to be a frontline bowler.
Yeah, definitely. That's what I've always wanted to be. I wanted to be number one bowler for Australia. And, you know, now that I've got my chance, sort of, I've just taken it. So as long as I can keep that up, then I'll be real happy.
It was by no means dead and buried for us. We always knew there was a bit in the wicket, but we certainly needed to bat well in the second innings.
So Ambrose, who was the destroyer for the West Indies in the first innings. And here he is now, bowled to Michael Slater. All the big fellas fired up. Through the slips, 4 runs.
Second innings were obviously still in the game because the West Indies only led by 8 runs, and you know, we thought if we could make 200 we'd be right in this game.
Big shout. And a great shout from behind the stumps.
And he goes under it. Irresistible.
That is a great shot from Michael Slater, especially at this time of the evening. It's a little bit darker than it has been most of the day today.
And that's the day.
Well, the third day of this test match, and we can see really a lot of difference in the pitch. Still a lot of grass on it. I think the only thing that you can say about this pitch is that it has dried out quite a lot. A few cracks are appearing on the surface. Still not going to be very easy for batting, but it just might be fractionally easier than yesterday.
Gone. Off the shoulder. The extra bounce. Slater has gone. He is really finding out just how tough it is when the test match cricket is taken to another level, as is always the case in the West Indies.
So he gets his revenge. Lovely leg cutter for the left-hander. And that's a wicket that the West Indies dearly wanted.
We needed to get a bit of a lead, but once again, Ambrose was very good, picked up another 4 wickets, coming off the confidence of Pfeiffer in the first innings. Courtney Walsh is a guy that always can turn a test match, and the West Indies had their noses in front, no doubt about that.
Chanderpaul.
David Boone can't believe his luck here. He's hit that right in the middle of the bat, straight to gully, and Chanderpaul has held on to a beauty.
Hooper doesn't drop those, and Waugh, after being struck on the arm, once again that back foot drive at the line of the ball and not the length, has caused the demise of Australia's in-form batsman, Steve Waugh.
The wicket never really improved. It was still a tough wicket to bat on.
Well, a big shout. He's given him. Australia loses two wickets in two balls. And Mark Waugh very late on the shot.
Well, the West Indies are striking back. It's 5 for 85 Australia.
Bowled in, right on, and Healy is gone. An astonishing session for the West Indies. And Healy, who has overseen so many rescue operations, cannot do it this time. Picks at it, and that's it again. Very loose, very loose. The mind games have taken over. The West Indians so mentally strong in a situation like this.
I didn't get any runs in the whole test match, and that was a tough one.
Hold him. Stay down a little bit. It stayed down a little bit. And he is on. He is routing them. Ambrose again. That stayed down. Julian shakes his head in disbelief. The Australians absolutely rocked.
On a pitch like that in Trinidad, you know, it was all their quick bowlers. It was Courtney Walsh, it was Curtly Ambrose, and even Benjamin came in with a couple of wickets as well. So full credit to them. They had their confidence, which is trying to hold back from them, but Trinidad certainly gave them that favour.
Well taken. Doesn't drop many, Carl Hooper. They low to his left. Courtney Walsh gets the wicket. Nine down now for 105. That's it, all over. Ambrose finishes it off with the throat ball. All out for 105. So 105, the West Indies will require 98 runs to win the match and level the series.
You know, the bowlers shared the wickets. There wasn't a standout bowler. They just all bowled well. And Tubby Taylor, I think, got top score with 30-odd. But having said that, I think, you know, we batted below par. We probably should have ground out 200, and if we'd done that, we would have been well in the game. You know, the excuses were there that the pitch was a bit tough to bat on, but, you know, we should have done better.
It's just interesting to see how the West Indies apply themselves to this, whether they're going to go out there playing shots or, you know, just go out there and defend, try and ease their way to this total.
The West Indies only needed 90-odd to win the game, and the wicket actually settled down a little bit by the time they batted.
And we were always behind the eight ball there. I mean, they had the confidence and the know-how to know that that's all they needed to do to win that test match.
Glenn McGrath, the man who took 6 for 47 in the first innings for Australia, will bowl in what will be the final innings of this match.
So Williams has put that away, and he's avoided the goggles. Off the mark with a boundary. Shot. And as Dean Jones was saying, not many drives we've seen in this match so far, and there's another one.
Well, that's a Richardson in-form shot. Here it is again, the ball outside the off stump. Well, pick the bones out of that. To Williams off the pick outside edge, and Paul Rifle not being rewarded for some very, very good bowling here this afternoon.
They got them quite easily. I think, you know, they just went out there and played their shots.
He's put that away pretty well. Not all that short. Well, that's vintage Richardson once more.
Even though the wicket had played poorly, you know, they were still in the box seat, and they just come out and batted particularly well. Got the runs in about 20 overs.
A glorious shot.
Super shot.
Well, the West Indies are doing it with boundaries here. He's got it down to third man, going after it short again, and once the short, Richardson is going to go after it. So 10 runs in Shane Warne's first over, the West Indies near their target.
It's as though he's getting the offer of a drink. Perhaps you would hope it was a cascade.
Glorious.
seemingly headed for a 10-wicket defeat. There's four more of them, Dean.
We had the momentum in the first test, the second test drawn, and in the third test, say, you know, they had the momentum.
Lara's now making his point.
Absolute class. The crowd are enjoying it.
Waits, drives, a header point, a glorious shot.
Brian Lara, just thinking he's got a dinner date on tonight. The game might be lost, but there are still other little psychological wars going on. Shane Warne would love to pick up his friend, Brian Lara.
That will be it. Magnificent blow. Clyde Cumberbatch signals four runs. Mark Taylor can scarcely believe it's happened. He must be in the deepest shock. The West Indians standing and applauding all around the ground. It has been a remarkable achievement.
Well, that wasn't the way we sort of envisaged the test match going, but you know, when you're playing the West Indies, you know, these things can happen. The conditions were tough, but we played poorly.
They were full of confidence. We were by no means dead and buried. I mean, we felt quite good that we'd played well in the test matches leading into that one.
I knew that we had to work hard in order to win. I believe if we played well, we would have won. I knew that there were going to be a result in this match. But I didn't think he would have won so comfortably.
You know, that second ball, the second over, one bounces off a link, gets the gloves and goes to the slips. You know, that was a little turning point. It got them going, and from then on we struggled.
You know, when we are down, we are most dangerous. And as you've seen here, that we bounce back and we won the game magnificently. So I'm quite happy.
You know, 1-1 going to the fourth test, you know, we're still a chance of winning the series. And I think if we could just get over this test match, forget about it and start fresh and in Kingston, Jamaica, then, you know, we're still very much on target to win this series.
Sabina Park's most impressive stands sits a little cottage. It's the office of this ground's longest-serving worker.
How long have you been a groundsman here?
37 years.
37?
Yeah. My first international wicket was in about 1969.
Charles Joseph, better known as Joe, is an eccentric curator, the Mr. Sheen of cricket, forever cleaning, waxing and polishing his most prized possession.
Keep coming.
Heard a bit about it, that they said that this pitch at Sabina Park was like a mirror.
Joe is proud of his work, but no job is a masterpiece unless it has a mirror-like finish.
And it was like glass. You could actually see your reflection in the pitch, so it was like bowling on an ice rink.
I like to put only shine on it, because without the shine, it couldn't get the ball come off the wicket quick.
The first step towards shining success is mud. Every crack is filled with clay, the foundation for endless hours of repetition.
You go to Sabina Park and it was just glazed clay, almost, you talk about it. You know, it was had the mosaics of cracking in it.
Curator there just polishes it. There's no grass on it.
The most unusual technique happens just before dusk. A little water with a twist of roller.
Welcome it!
We were watching you last night spin the roller around. What does that do?
Well, that gives it, bring up the shine in it. Without you doing that, the wicket don't have any face in it. It just have a chalk look, looking like about the end of the pitch there.
Now remember, little mosaics on top of the pitch, when your spikes go in, if you can get them in, they'd sort of pop out.
Good ball, Warney. Hey, Warney, good ball.
While some workers expect the pitch to spin, the boss knows differently.
I go on the watch, you know. I'll go with the watch. I think we make a lot of difference on this pitch. I want to see bowling, you know? Pitch like these in Jamaica. I seen bowl some wicked ball.
With this the series decider, thousands tried to force their way into Sabina Park.
The series at that stage, 1-1, there was a lot of interest going into that last test match, because there was just that sense that, you know, the West Indies might, you know, they're great dominant period might be coming to an end.
Police horses and dogs were brought in to disperse the crush.
Step back!
Caught in the middle, Australian tourists.
Absolute madness this is.
The West Indies is quite a unique place to play cricket, and you know, the crowds really get involved. You know, there's a lot of music, and you know, they're quite festive, and they don't mind throwing a bit of abuse at the Australian players too, if they get the chance. But they're very passionate. They love their cricket. Sabina Parker is, you know, they're as rowdy a crowd as I've seen for a while. Especially if the fast bowlers in the West Indies get on a bit of a roll, you know, they really get fired up.
It's a good toss to win. And bat first on that. That was my impression.
Well, heading into Jamaica on a very flat pitch at Sabina Park, it was very shiny, and there's no doubt that if you win the toss, you're going to bat first. Toby Tarr had lost three in a row. He was due to win one, you wouldn't believe it. He lost again.
How many times is that?
Well, I think I have a 100% winning record.
And what are your intentions? Do you know exactly what you're going to be doing yet?
Well, yeah, we're going to have a bat. there's a bit of some unusual cracks in the wicket, so we believe that maybe later on these cracks might open, so it's best to have a go early.
That was a bit of a chance to actually look at the pitch and see how it played.
These cracks should not influence the game in any way. The cracks are not wide at all. It's the first day and the cracks are appearing. It does look like as if they might widen.
Sometimes that's an advantage in a test match. At a venue, you know, you don't play it that often. Crowds make the atmosphere there. They're very noisy. There's usually a band playing.
You could swear that Rastafarians are packed out to the ruck as they're in Jamaica. And...
Oh, and she's going to have a little bit of the red stripe too. What joy.
Sabina Park is so close. The grandstand at both ends is right on top of you.
Yeah, it's a little bit confronting if you're not quite used to it, but, you know, it's all part of Test cricket, you know, the crowd getting involved and, you know, it's great fun. And
good place to play cricket, but when you're trying to concentrate on your cricket, it can be hard.
Well, it's a big crowd here. It's a full house at Sabina Park.
Every vantage point being gained.
A real sense of anticipation here at the ground. The ground's very full. Just everyone just has a great expectation of what's in front of us here. It's going to be a great game.
And all is in readiness. The first ball will be bowled by Paul Rifle of Australia.
We started pretty well. Picked up an early wicket.
And he's gone. Brilliantly caught by Blewett. Brilliantly caught, throwing himself. A sensational start for the Australians.
Richard Richardson was actually opening the batting, and in came Brian Lara at number three.
And just listen to this roar now for Brian Lara. Hardly a spare seat to be had, and what must be running through his mind now?
He always felt that Richardson or Lara, if they could turn it on and get a bit of confidence moving forward, that they'd put you under a lot of pressure, and they did.
Shorter, but inside that, and that'll go for four. That's a glorious shot back, placing it perfectly. There's the famous Lara hip clip. How well is he seeing them, this young man?
Sliced away off the edge. Didn't go where he intended. Well, that asked for it. Magnificently struck. It was short, it was wide, it was four.
Sometimes you've got to sit back and you've got to admire just really good batsmanship. I mean, Lara hadn't really fired, and you thought, well, this is the game he could do it. Richie Richardson hadn't fired as well.
And nobody's going to stop that boundary. All Michael Slater can do is go and pick it up out of the fence.
Beautiful wrist work and beautiful timing. Four runs. Magnificent stroke. No effort whatever.
In the air for a wide, but McGrath has fumbled and Shane Warne is not too pleased. Dabs it for the 50 and the crowd go nuts. A wonderful inning so far from Brian Lara.
It was a 100-run partnership. Everything was just going really well for the West Indies. The crowd was on their side.
foot there and whacked that through the fence for four.
Oh. Split the difference. Four runs.
It was always a bit of a battle between Shane Warne and Brian Lara to see who was going to be the most dominant. I mean, that pitch was very difficult for Warne to bowl on because it just did not turn at all. It was shiny and the ball just sort of skidded on.
It just goes to show he didn't get that as he liked. Slater couldn't make the interception.
And Warne bowled particularly well to him. It was the first time that Shane Warne actually picked up Brian Lara.
Leaning forward and great embrace. And he's gone. He has walked.
And Lara, in fact, just got caught behind and walked straight off. There was no sort of given out by the umpire. To his credit, Brian Lara, he thought he nicked it. And I think he might have nicked it or might have been a bit dubious. It wasn't clear cut anyway, but it made it easy for the umpire. It made it easy for us, so we didn't mind.
You see the ball pitching, just catching the inside edge of the bat, flying up. Good reactions from Ian Healy. And
Lara has walked. 2 for 103. What a dramatic moment.
For me, I really wanted to make a point. It was my fourth test match over there and the last test match, which would have obviously decided the series. But picking up Jimmy Adams and Carl Hooper, I think it just gave me a little bit of confidence. I mean, two good batsmen that have played pretty well.
Gone. Straight to Slater. Short. It's miscued. You're right, he has hit his straps, caught by Warne, driving away, picked that perfectly, Dean.
Richardson always felt as captain the pressure was on him. He hadn't sort of batted that well leading into the series. And it just seemed to be his moment on that day, day one.
It's gone a long way. It's over the top at six. Not afraid to drop it short.
Hooper's gone over the top with that. There's a man down there. One bounce.
Fine stroke. The boundary straight down the ground is short enough that it can reach it for a bunt. Yeah, I get your point, Dean. Again.
Well, we've got a game on here.
Classic Richie Richardson, that'll take him to 99.
One to go.
That's it. Test centuries, 9 against Australia, the first one for 2 years and 4 months.
He's gone, outside the off stump, edged, around the wicket, Atherton goes to McGrath.
Catch! It's a big appeal, Boone, and he's been given. So the wrong'un from Warne deceives the batsman. Shout, and that's out. Yes, it is. Tended to whack the ball around behind square leg across the line. Big shout, that's out. So the new ball for Australia has taken 2 wickets already, and it's only 5 deliveries old.
Yeah, it's always interesting Test cricket because as the game unfolds, you always get these little battles between players, and obviously the third test at Port of Spain, Stephen and Kirtley Ambrose had a bit of a heated exchange, and then that's carried through into the next test in Kingston, Jamaica, where Kirtley was batting and this time Stephen was bowling.
Well, Kirtley's flicking it behind him.
I think he served him up 3 or 4 bounces in a row, so just sort of stirring him up.
Aggressive bowling from Steve Waugh.
Again, or maybe he was getting in a few short ones before he came out to bat. So, you know, it was pretty, it was good stuff. Kirtley's, you know, he doesn't take a backward step either, a bit like Stephen, so.
Oh, a hook shot had been brought out of the bag.
Yeah, it was the start of a, another little battle, which Stephen won. I think Kirtley didn't get too many runs, as you'd expect, so all good fun.
It's in the air. Will David Boone get to it? He will, and he won't drop that.
That's the end of the innings. Good catch by Healy, high to his right. And it's all over. A rifle picks up the last wicket. The West Indies are all out for 265.
We always felt when we came off, having bowled them out for that score, we were terribly confident.
It's been a good day for the Australians.
You know, we're well in the game after, you know, bowling the West Indies out for 265, so that's a great start to the fourth test.
What do you think on this pitch is a match-winning score? Pressure's on Australia now.
About 600, yeah.
We needed to make a lot of runs, so someone needed to put their hand up, and a couple of guys did.
How important is mental toughness in a series such as this?
Well, it's probably one of the greatest aspects when you're playing the West Indies. They're always very mentally tough. They keep you playing. They've got good fast bowlers who keep you on your toes all the side all the time. You've got to be mentally tough and mentally aggressive. This is another opportunity to become a great side.
The first inning score we thought was very achievable. We thought we could probably chase that down.
We just had a lot of work to do and we needed to make a lot of runs.
Beautifully taken. What a magnificent catch by Jimmy Adams. Remarkable.
Well, the fielding in the whole Test series was outstanding. Not only the West Indies, but also the Australians as well. Jimmy Adams took a fantastic catch to get rid of Mark Taylor.
And there has been none better than that.
That is unbelievable.
David Boone got out, given caught behind, may have come off the helmet as well.
He's got to go, and I think he's achieved just that. He has. So Boone's not too pleased. And as the umpire calls drinks, the West Indies celebrate.
Well, if that hit anything, it seems as if it hit the helmet. That's probably why David Boone was a bit disappointed. It's 2 for 50.
Really set the standard from both teams. I can only remember maybe two or three catches from both sides that got dropped throughout the whole series.
In the air, Lara takes it beautifully.
Once again, short ball, bit top edge-ish. Brian Lara moving fantastically to his right, takes a superb catch, which is starting to become regulation for this series. The end of Michael Slater, 27, Australia 3 for 73.
And we're under a fair bit of pressure, and then in step Mark Waugh and Steve Waugh, who once again sort of really showed how classy they are.
So I remember going in the bat and there was a real intimidation factor playing in Jamaica. They were bowling quite quick, a lot of bounces. And to be honest, I wasn't feeling overly confident going into that innings.
Some gentlemen have different superstitions. Mark Waugh has a little one in regards to having stick men with his hundreds put on his thigh pad.
It's not as easy as it looks against the West Indies. You're always going to get short pitch bowling and you know that's going to happen. You've just got to hang in there. You're going to wear a few on the body.
That was predictable, very predictable. But he is going to be in for a very, very torrid time.
Got to bounce the first ball, sort of ducked under it. I was almost ducking before Kirtley Ambrose bowled me the balls. If you've got bruises, you've normally made runs. If you've got no bruises, you haven't made any runs, so you accept that as a batsman.
That's a glorious shot. That's characteristic of Mark Waugh in full flight.
That sort of got me going, and then just played really well. I remember sort of stroking the ball beautifully. And
two different styles of batsman. Steve Waugh just seemed to be playing really well off his test match.
Got that off the hip pretty convincingly.
And at the other end, Mark played the classic Mark Waugh innings. You know, it made it look easy, but worked really hard as well. He copped a fair bit of short pitch bowling.
It's gone very fine and gone for four. Well, a slow ball from Walsh and over-pitching and driven away for four.
Not much talk between us. We sort of wander up at the end of each over and look at each other, then just turn back and go back to the other end. So I'd say less talk between myself and Steve.
Gives him a full toss, which he hammers.
When you're batting well, it sort of seems to flow. You don't have to talk about too much, really. I mean, the conditions were pretty good. The batting was, the pitch was good to bat on. So you know, we just spoke about keep going and keep concentrating.
That's a lovely shot.
Every player's different. Like, there's some guys you have a bit of a chat to. Mark Taylor's pretty good. Ricky Ponting, used to chat with him a fair bit. And Steven, yeah, just not much sort of communication. Just sort of look at each other and say, yep, we're right to go. And, you know, just keep going from there.
A glorious shot, the square drive.
Well, no third man again, and he's letting the other one receive the applause of the crowd, and so will Mark Waugh for his half century. Well, what a surprise, there's no mid on, and that will nearly go all the way.
It's funny because you get into that test match in Jamaica and the one drop catch was a pretty easy one. Courtney Brown dropping Stephen Waugh in the 40s.
Oh, he dropped it! He's put it down. Well, poor Courtney Brown will not be feeling too happy about that.
Yeah, it was actually a sitter. He got dropped and you know, I think, you know, when you got to make the most of those sort of simple, you know, chances. You don't get dropped by the keeper too often. And
was probably something that the West Indies just could not fathom. As I said, the high quality of catching was unbelievable. But just that one moment, that breath of luck for Stephen Waugh got us over the line.
It's a glorious drive from Waugh. Well fielded, but there's his 50.
Me at the other end, you know, I was hitting him in the middle.
Well, that's four. Finally, very, very fine.
But as it turned out, you know, I played really well.
Shot that he played with some success irritated West Indians beyond measure, and I sense it might be irritating them again.
Never feeling in too much discomfort at the crease, and obviously the partnership with Stephen, you know, that's one of those things you dream of.
It's a magnificent shot for four.
Yeah, it was pretty perfect sort of playing.
And that's well put away, tremendous stroke. Got into it and really hit it very, very hard.
That was an innings where, as you watched it, it gave confidence to the side. And I've watched Mark and Steve Waugh in amazing partnerships because I've been on the back end of it in state cricket. So once they got going, gee, it was good to watch, and you had to sit back and admire that.
That's well hit. Tremendous blow. Way over mid-wicket, got under it. From the time that left the bat and you heard the sound, you know where it was going to go.
I know Steve always gets the accolades that he was gutsy in that, but it was only because Mark made it look so easy that he probably doesn't. I mean, he was trying just as hard as his brother.
Can't yet be really taken into account. That's a beautiful shot. But he will not be on 99 any longer. His 8th test century for Mark Waugh. Applause from the Australian players.
Well, I'd say that's probably the most important partnership that, you know, we've ever put together. When we scored runs in club cricket, junior cricket, Shield cricket.
That's what he's trying to say. He's got another stick on the thigh man, stick man.
But to do it in the West Indies when the team needs it against a good quality bowling attack, you know, it's got to rate as our best partnership and be right up there with my best innings.
That's a lovely shot, and it may in fact go all the way. Yes, it will. Timing and placement.
They stuck it out really well, and I think that's the thing that got them through. The West Indies thought that they could probably just get in there, bounce them out, and it didn't happen.
Going to go for it. Lifts his bat to the dressing room. Mark Taylor stands, his captain. Probably his finest moment, his 8th test match century.
Well, he was just in his own. I mean, you could tell how badly not only the team wanted to win this series.
This is different to a 100 in the backyard at Mum's.
To make it a really big knot, he wasn't happy with 100.
He's gone. Mark Waugh is out. Right around the corner.
Yeah, obviously I was disappointed to get out when I was batting so well in that first innings, but I actually had something in my eye. I know it sounds like an excuse, but I did. But because Carl Hooper was bowling, I thought, oh, it won't matter. I'll just be able to defend it anyway.
Mark Waugh, who's played the innings of his lifetime.
I should have actually pulled away because I did have a bit of grass or something flew in my eye. That's my excuse anyway, but couldn't, and he got me.
You know, that partnership, you know, got us into a great position. There's no doubt about that. We went past their first innings total. And
now Greg Blewett waits, arrives after nearly 4 hours of waiting.
Yeah, actually sitting there waiting to bat wasn't a very comfortable feeling for me. 20 minutes, half an hour to go before the end of the day's play. So for me, it was just trying to get through to stumps. probably didn't sleep much the rest of that night because I knew I was in the next day. Curtly Ambrose was bowling from the other end of it. I remember him getting me on the gloves.
The search and delivery from Curtly Ambrose banged in. It's very well played. Get the gloves out of the road.
The pull and hook shot used to come quite naturally to me, but for some reason it was just the extra bounce. I just couldn't quite get to him. And I sort of decided next one he bowls short, I'm just going to go after it. And I sort of almost closed my eyes and absolutely middled it.
He's put that away very well.
And went for four, and I reckon the next ball might have been a half volley, and I got him down the ground as well for another four.
Well struck. Just eased it down the ground for the first boundary of the day.
That actually, those two balls from Curtly Ambrose probably got me, you know, going just as much as the previous boundaries.
Greg Bull came out and played a gem of an innings. He got 60-odd, but it really gave us the injection that we needed.
Great shot through point off the back foot. Four runs.
Well struck.
I think it probably just suited me. I mean, I opened the batting a lot for South Australia.
He was important because he got his runs quickly. And also he counter-punched well because he was such a good hooker and puller of the ball. So in other words, when they tried to bang the ball in to try and do a bit of intimidating sort of bowling, you know, Greg was up to it.
Lovely shot. That's just good. Who looks in very, very good, calm touch.
And I think the West Indies were just dead and buried then. We'd sort of put them into a position where they felt that they could lose this test match. And once we got them on the back foot, it was never going to be easy.
Really just started to take the game away from the West Indies.
It's in the air, but he's placed it well behind square. It's 4 for 396.
I made 69, and when you get to that stage in a test match innings, you know, you're pretty close to getting to 100, and I was on a bit of a roll. I was almost scoring in a run of ball, so I got out to Keith Arthurton, of all people.
He's got him. Keith Arthurton has broken the partnership with what really was a long hop.
Yeah, I was really disappointed, but also knowing that, you know, I went into the change rooms and, you know, speaking to the guys, you could tell that everyone was really happy with the contribution. I mean, all the hard work was set up by the two war boys, but, yeah, got a lot of, you know, pats on the back.
Full credit to Greg Blewett. He'd missed out in the first couple of test matches, hadn't batted that well, but we always knew he could play well.
That's a glorious square drive. Onto the front foot. Placing it perfectly. Very sweetly, he was really digging it out, one little thought. There it is. 150 for Steve Waugh. Gives his bat. The crowd again.
He's not going to get out. He's just got to weather the storm and occupy the crease.
And he batted quite superbly. I mean, you know, that gritty determination that we know him well for.
I don't think he's too happy, but that seems to have just taken him on the elbow.
Oh, that's hit him on the elbow, yes. Of the back arm. He's seen wearing an arm guard in the front arm, but just missed the bat and bang. I can guarantee that hurts. As we mentioned earlier, we make runs against this bowling attack from the West Indies. You've got to be prepared to wear a few.
But also, you know, just he was able to play a bit more expansive role because the ball was coming onto the bat nicely, and we just all saw all the trademark Steve Waugh shots.
Beautiful straight drive. No need to run for that, he says.
But yeah, a bit of everything. Really good cricket to watch.
And that could go for four. There's a long chase around for Kenny Benjamin, who's picked it up rather late. They could run four here. Kenny Benjamin is not the fastest of fielders in the West Indies team, and they'll come for the fourth, which will bring in his 200.
What a magnificent effort. One of the greatest moments in his career. The Australians running out from everywhere here. Standing ovation here in Kingston. Shame here. The crowd comes out. Steve Waugh, a bit of air to take the applause from the crowd.
Yeah, Greg Ritchie jumped the fence, or he was up in the grandstand and sort of rolled over the top onto the ground and ended up in the dirt and ran out onto the field. And
there is a rather less familiar figure than in his playing days, former Australian Test batsman Greg Ritchie. So overcome with emotion that he also joined the celebrants out in the middle.
So, yeah, that was something different. Yeah, you wouldn't see that in Australia.
So we got a bit of amusement out of that. And I remember a guy also that came out from the hill. He was running out there to shake Steve Waugh's hand. He was bouncing an Aussie Rules footy on the way out there.
Time and again, we've had spectators on the field.
Yeah, it's just one of those places where, you know, there wasn't a lot of security around the ground, so if you wanted to run around the ground, you could. And a lot of the Aussies and a lot of the West Indies were out there as well.
Appeal, and he's given. So Steve Waugh is out. Stood there to wait for the decision. And Kenny Benjamin picks up the last three wickets, and Steve Waugh goes caught by Lara off that bouncer for an even 200.
Steve Waugh had a great tour, there's no doubt about that, and what a great way to finish it off with 200. And he just gutted out, really, and put away the loose ball. And, you know, any time you make a 200 in Test match cricket, it's obviously a great knock, but in those sort of circumstances when we're trying to win the series against the West Indies at home, it was right up there.
Yeah, well, I've had a lot of tough times against the West Indies, like most batsmen, and I think when you get the opportunity to make a big score, yeah, it'd be crazy not to try and get as many as possible.
Yeah, I mean, to make 100 against the West Indies in Jamaica is probably as good a test as you can get, and it was a good wicket to bat on, but, you know, you're always in the back of your mind, you know, they've got four fast bowlers who can bang the ball in and can get you out any ball.
I was pretty determined today to try and get a big lead because I know the wicket's going to play a few tricks in the last couple of days, and we're definitely in the box seat now.
What a fine innings by Steve Waugh. Last man out, all out for 531.
We led by 266 on the first inning. Stephen was the last man out for 200, and then that gave us 14 overs on that third evening to bowl at the West Indies, which is always uncomfortable for, you know, a batsman because you can't really make many runs. All you can do is get out.
Very fine indeed. Just a couple of touch on it.
Steve Waugh coming back onto the field now. Apparently had 70% of his body covered with ice packs.
Shot of the match. You don't hit them any better or any more sweetly than that.
You know, there's a bit of pace and bounce in the track, so if you've got the new ball there or thereabouts, you know, you could get stuck into the batsman, and yeah, we needed early wickets, and that's what happened.
Out. Caught and bowled, and the breakthrough that Australia so desperately wanted this evening.
Four off, a very consistent bowler and a good bowler too. Yeah, good start from him.
He's hit straight in front and he's gone. What a sensational breakthrough for the Australians. Rifle.
And getting Brian Lara on that third evening, and we're still a long way in front, that was really going to make it tough for the West Indies to come back from there.
Played on. He's played on. And Stuart Williams is out.
Poor Rifle bowled really well. Picked up all three wickets, but pick up Lara and Richardson late on day three, I think, just set the tone.
He was a bit of an unsung hero, I think, throughout that series, particularly in that game. He really tormented Brian Lara and Richardson, you know, two of the players. Even though they'd made runs in the first innings, you could really see him, you know, making life difficult for them.
To have those guys back in the sheds and one hand firmly gripped on the Sir Frank Wold Trophy was something we weren't going to let go. I mean, we just knew heading into day four, if we just do all those things well, that the West Indies would probably crumble. Heading into the fourth day, it all fell into place.
And as you can see, actually there are pieces of leather that have chipped off of the ball in these cracks because of the hardness of the wicket. I think batting on this pitch today is going to be very, very difficult.
Just needed to bowl well, and we had plenty of time left in the game.
Yeah, leading into the fourth day, the West Indies needed 220 to make us bat again, and the atmosphere was pretty low-key at the ground that day. There wasn't many West Indies supporters there. They'd probably given up on the West Indies, given the first 3 days.
And it all sort of fell into place.
Gone, brilliantly caught. Stephen Waugh, full length to his right, wonderful catch in the gully, ever alert.
Some good bowling from everyone, and some good catching as well.
Confident appeal he's given him. Buckner has given him. Benjamin is out.
Out in the boundary, he clipped it to deep square. He tried to come back for the second. It was a one-hand pickup and threw the stumps down, the keeper's out.
The hurry. Ah! Called for it. Ali Mavert's called for it. The Australians think he's out. They're confident.
I remember thinking, you know, it's just like the first test. It just started to go our way.
And he's gone. Run out.
It's just one of those things where you think, you know, this is our day, and it just happened to be the final sort of test match where we needed to win.
Well, a big appeal again, and he's given him. And he's turned and hit the back leg. Almost stumped. Warn has dragged him forward. Ambrose premeditating the delivery. And a big cheer for another local hero, Courtney Walsh.
Oh, that's a superb stroke by Courtney Walsh. Steve Waugh special.
That's a crackerjack shot, this. That's a magnificent year, Tony.
Jamaica, of course, and they love him.
Sort of cheering and waving, but it is a great atmosphere, and the West Indies people are so parochial.
It's in the air. Lewis under it, and he has taken it.
Courtney Walsh tried the big one over the top and hit it straight to point.
And so Warn strikes again. And Courtney Walsh, who was so solid. The Australians have had wonderful support. Bob Simpson there, the coach.
The team camaraderie and the team spirit between the two of them, which is a great sight to see.
Look, I think it was just a magic moment for everyone. We always felt confident leading into the test match. We felt confident leading right through it as well. Paul Rifle continued his good form. He got four. Shane Warne ended up getting the last wicket. Kenny Benjamin went with a big shot, I think way over mid-wicket or wherever. Anyway, didn't go that far. A little edge straight to Mark Taylor.
And it's been caught by Taylor. How appropriate is that? Warn, everybody gathering to hug Taylor and Warn. Simpson, what a moment. The Australians running on to the ground.
It was quite fitting that the skipper took the catch and we won the series on that last wicket.
You know, you're seeing it, but you know, we believe it. We've actually beaten the West Indies in the series for the first time in, you know, donkey's years. So
we always felt that we were always in the game, but you never really can express those emotions until it happens. And look, it was just amazing. You know, everyone sort of ran together. We hugged each other, and it was just a relief too. We felt that we were under pressure, you know, leading into the whole Test series. We'd lost some injuries. Our key bowlers, Fleming and Craig McDermott, had gone home. But, you know, we stuck it out and we played particularly well.
The joy of being in the West Indies over in their soil hadn't been done for a while, and the West Indies had a great sort of 80s and 90s. They were number one for a long time. So, you know, it just wasn't a normal win. It was a real changing in the guard in world cricket. And, you know, I think for the Australian point of view, it was the start of a great era, you know, for us, which has continued on to now.
It's been a great win here today, and I think this is just the best time of my life to win over here. I know it means a lot more to like Simo and Babsy and players like that have been here a few times, but for a guy that's been here for the first time, it's just been magnificent.
It was crunch time at 3 for 73 batting, and to get a lead and make them not make us not bat again was the critical thing, and the Wars just dominated for a day and a half, and Wow, that's unbelievable. We've just got to make sure we dominate for a few more years yet.
My first time playing against the West Indies and we've won it, so I've got half a cheese sandwich in my mouth at the moment, but it's a great feeling, really.
Didn't your mum ever tell you not to speak with your mouth full?
She did, but I think I'm going to get away with a few baddies tonight, so but it's going to be a lot of celebration and well-deserved. The guys have played extremely well. Now, I suppose that puts us number one in the world and, you know, the others can try and knock us off. So we've got the advantage of being the top dogs and hopefully we can keep playing well.
What did you learn just sitting on the sidelines for four tests?
We've seen how important it is to beat the West Indies, that feeling and being involved in it, you know, invaluable experience and, you know, how well our guys have played, the Australian brand of cricket. And, you know, if we can pick something up, I'm sure we have. You know, we haven't been out in the middle, but we've picked up, we've seen the atmosphere.
How do you feel?
Oh, shit ass, mate. Feeling good, mate. Tremendous. Great effort by the boys. Well deserved.
Yeah, well, it looks like Bernie's going to do his job, is he?
He'll, the famous song's coming out, mate, yeah.
Simo, there can't be many more proud moments than this.
It's great. I think it's the proudest moment I've known, Dave. We've, you know, been here 9 years. We've won a World Cup. We've got the Ashes.
Richie, you have lost a series after a very long time. What does it feel like to have lost a series?
Well, I'm very, very disappointed. I cannot believe that we allowed Australia to beat us. In my opinion, it's the weakest Australian team that I've played against, and I think that we allowed them to beat us because we didn't play well, we didn't bat well at all in the series, and because of this, they took the series from us.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm not sure how many people out there can hear me, but today I have to be the most proudest man in world cricket. It's been far too long since Australia have had their hands on this trophy. I feel very honoured that I am the captain of a side that has finally won this back after some 20 years.
Underneath the summit, Cross got a workout in there.
It got a big workout this time, yeah, and I'm sure it hasn't finished yet either.
But is this the ultimate?
Well, I think it's pretty close because it's been so long and first side to do it for a long time. I've been waiting 12 years for this and it's worth every moment of it. May the 3rd, 1994. Won't be forgotten.
Wow. Borny, you having a good time?
Yeah, why not, mate? Why not?
And as a young man now, you have the responsibility of winning the next four Frank Worrell trophies.
I'm in a wheelchair, mate. I'll be bowling in a wheelchair if that happens.
Steve, you haven't taken the hat off yet.
Mate, I'm not taking it off tonight. There's a couple of guys that aren't taking off. Slats, Lang, myself, and who's the other one? There's, and Ian Healy. We're keeping on all night.
Does that tell the story? Is that a sense of the team spirit?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, this is the greatest victory of our careers, and we worked hard to get it. And to beat the West Indies in the West Indies, that's the ultimate. They haven't lost a series in 15 years, so to beat these guys, it's just fantastic.
That double ton sunk in you?
Nothing's sinking at the moment, mate. The Southern Comfort's been anything sinking at the moment. But I'm sure in a couple of days, time it will.
I do remember going into the dressing rooms to congratulate the boys, and obviously they were cock a hoop, and there was a great celebration going on. So it was good to just be, you know, part of that, even though hadn't actually played, just to sort of see Australian cricket, you know, start their period of dominance and in very emphatic style.
I mean, that was a great thing too, and hopefully it's still the same. I mean, whenever Australia won a test match or, you know, definitely won a series, I mean, we made sure we celebrated hard and enjoyed each other's success. And I remember the cameras coming in afterwards and doing interviews, and there was, you know, stuff going on everywhere. There was family in the room. So, yeah, it was just one of the great moments of my career.
I think it was sort of a watershed moment in Australian cricket. That win, since then, it's sort of been Australia being at the top of the tree. And, you know, I think it goes to show you, if you sort of got determination in your squad and, you know, belief in that squad, you can do anything.
Australian cricket was on the up and the West Indies maybe on the way down.
It's hard work against these guys. They're a great cricket side. You've got to play at the top to beat them. We've won here this time. We've got to come back here in 99, and they'll be as tough, if not tougher, next time. And fortunately, the Ricky Ponnings and the Justin Langers, you know, those sort of guys will know the experience and will gain a lot from it. And we'll be there and ready to stave them off and hopefully hang on to this trophy, which is so hard to get hold of.